it's easy to speak something. You know, it's easy to tell a lie even if you believe it. Look at Peter. You know, oh, Lord, I will go with you even unto death. Jesus, I don't know Jesus. You know, we need to look into our hearts to see if he is preeminent, to see if he is the only one. And if he's not, then we need to get on our knees and say, Lord, whatever I have placed before you, whatever I have preferred before you. Jesus said, if you don't hate your mother, your father, your brother, your sister, even yourself, you cannot be my disciples. And when he said this, it doesn't mean have, you know, a vitriolic emotion against them, because he would contradict the word, because one of the Ten Commandments is to honor your father and your mother. But he said this to mean that if you don't prefer me over yourself, if you don't prefer me over your wife, over your brother, your sister, your father, or your mother, then you cannot be my disciple, because either Jesus is first in your life or he is nothing in your life.
Well, you know, it says in the book of Isaiah that when my judgments are upon the earth, then will the inhabitants of the earth learn righteousness. And it looks like it's going to take, I like how Benjamin Baruch put it. He said a wire brush and a blowtorch is what it's going to take for some people. And it looks like that, Brother Michael, these days are coming, and God's going to have to do it. He's going to turn the heat up and shake the very lives of so many people who are not waking up. And that leads me to a question that I have for you. I know that God has shown you a lot of dreams and visions and things that are coming. Can you share some of those things about the landscape that's going to be here in the next year or two, or not putting a timeline, but...
First, I want to touch on something that you just mentioned, which is there needing to be like a blowtorch to get the church to wake up. Unfortunately, I think there will be a very great separation in the church. I think a great majority, when they see these things coming, and when they see, when they're living in them, rather than repent before God, they will rebel against God. You know, and that's the tragedy of it. I think people, even right now, that call themselves Christians, will shake their fist at God in fury, because in their minds, it's not what they signed up for. You know, they were given a bubblegum Christianity. They were given a gospel that only gave them stuff. Come to Jesus, he'll give you a new car, a big house, a wife, an acne-free face. I mean, come to Jesus, you win the lotto, basically. You know, and when they see troubles and trials and persecutions, when they see tribulation, these people are going to shake their fist at God. Now, those that love Jesus for Jesus, those that believed Christ at his word when he said, all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution, I believe those people will shine like the sun. I believe God will do miracles and work wonders in them and through them. I believe they will be great warriors for Christ. As far as the things that God has shown me, I think one of the things that I've been dealing with lately is something in my grandfather's prophecy about America, actually, that I hadn't seen the possibility of up until maybe 3 months ago. In his prophecy, he said one of the harbingers, one of the things that preceded an attack on America, was that there would be an internal revolution, like a civil uprising. And for the life of me, I couldn't see that happening in America. I said, you know, I believe it, but I don't see how that's possible. You know, it's America, United We Stand, land of the free and all that. In the last 3 months, I've seen that division. And I've seen that animosity grow, and now I see the possibility of that. And it amazes me how close we are. It's one of those things that I latched on, and I couldn't have wrapped my head around it a year ago. I couldn't have explained it to anyone a year ago. Now I can explain it. Yes, there will be civil unrest in this country. I think that's one of the things that we're going to see very soon. I believe that there's going to be a new war, whether spurned by other nations, you know. Up until recently, I thought it was Iran. It wasn't that I received revelation it would be Iran, but all the indicators pointed to it. I didn't make it public because it wasn't God telling me, so, you know, I keep my opinions to myself, basically, because my opinions have no place when it comes to prophecy or when it comes to revelation. So I kept it to myself. Now I'm uncertain of what nation it will be, but I know that we will be at war again as a nation. I believe that natural disasters are going to increase exponentially. They've already started throughout the world. I think the economy is going to go from bad to worse. I believe that a lot of people that we consider allies or friends are going to turn their back on us because, you know, when God's hand is against you, nothing goes right. you know, every choice could be made perfectly well and perfectly right and still turn out horribly wrong. This is what's happening. And it's going to get much worse. Because rather than repent and turn to God, we're running towards sin faster than ever. We're accepting things and we're embracing things, even within the church, that are an abomination to God. We don't call sin sin anymore. Everything's a big gray area, and to God there is no gray area. It's either black or white. It's either righteous or unrighteous. And we've made this umbrella covering tolerance and inclusiveness and subjectivity where, well, you know, it's all relative. You don't feel the way I feel, but we can all agree to disagree. No, we can't. I'm sorry. This is what the Word of God says. Repent or be judged. I didn't make it up. I wish it weren't so. Honestly, I do. I love this country. I've been living here for the better part of my life. And there's so much good in this country, but good doesn't outweigh evil. Repentance neutralizes evil. You know, this is what we don't understand. Oh, we do good. Yes, we do. We're charitable people. We're a giving people. But we've distanced ourselves from the source of life. We've distanced ourselves from truth. We've distanced ourselves from the Word of God and from God Himself. And there can be no blessing absent of God. And this is what is difficult for so many people to understand. Because we're still living with this idea that, you know, we're God's people, so He's never going to judge us. Well, He is judging us. You know, natural disasters, they're not just flukes. They're the judgments of God. This is what the Bible says. When Israel rebelled, God sent an earthquake, swallowed up dozens, you know, tons of people. We need to realize that God gets angry, and God is just, and God is righteous, and God judges. We cannot have one view of God and stick to it. Oh, God is love. Keep on walking. I'm sorry. You know, He's not one-dimensional. God is multidimensional. But as far as what I see happening in the near future, I think that it will cause the world to stand up and take note. I feel in my heart that something awful is coming to this country very soon. I haven't received exactly what. I had a dream of a bigger earthquake in California some years ago. Right now, there have been earthquakes all around there. But again, when we rebel against God, nothing goes right. And this is the season that we're in right now. Nothing's going right. Everything seems to be going wrong, and at a certain point, the people of this nation are going to start to rebel, and I fear for that time when there's the civil unrest in this country.
You know, Brother Michael, you just mentioned that you feel that something very big is coming to this nation, and it's real interesting that in early February, I had a prophetic dream where I saw the Statue of Liberty and her head fell off, and then I had the same dream again, and this time it was the hand of God that came out of the clouds with a large sword that chopped her head off. And over time and in prayer, God told me that that dream meant that liberty is going to be decapitated here in America. And when I was seeking Him, it was a very, very heavy time of travailing because He showed me and told me that just what you just said, a very, very bad event is going to come to this country, and it's going to test people in ways that they never imagined. And people and fathers and mothers need to be preparing their households right now. They need to be praying for their family and their loved ones and preparing for this thing. And then it's real interesting that several weeks later is when David Wilkerson released his urgent warning where he said a very large event is also going to come to America. And that was in the span of 2 weeks that happened. And now I hear you saying this. And you know, God is sharing with all his messengers the same voice that the people of God need to prepare for what's coming. And even still, I've noticed that when people hear this warning message, while they're listening, they might become alarmed and look at their husband or wife while they're listening to the recording or the radio show. And maybe for an hour or two, they are a little bit sober. But then by the end of the day, it's back to regular business. And still the people fall back to sleep. And, you know, how long can God keep warning over and over?
I believe all the warnings of God are a testament to His mercy. You know, He's hoping against hope that, you know, a handful of people wake up so that they be spared. This is the amazing thing about our God. But, you know, as far as Him warning, He warned so that His children would not be ignorant. You know, we shouldn't be walking around like the rest of the world not knowing what's going to happen. This is the beauty of being people of God, is that we know, we see what's coming. And if we see what's coming, then it's incumbent upon us to prepare for what's coming. As far as the Statue of Liberty having its head cut off, let's face it, you know, know, I am with no political party. I have no political affiliation. But we are witnessing the death of freedom in this country. You know, everything that's happening or that's been happening for the past few months is exactly how it started in my country. So this is very troublesome, especially for people who lived under that kind of regime, who knew the tactics. We are seeing the death of freedom. And I think this is one of those things that are going to spark the powder keg. Something has to spark it. There has to be a catalyst. And I think one more thing that's going to happen is there's going to be persecution on the children of God, on the true children of God. And I think the wolves are to blame. I think the greedy men that made up the pulpit a means of gain are to blame. But they're testing the limits every single day. You know, they're telling people they can't have Bible study in their homes anymore, that God pushed back. But, you know, it's going to be something else and something else. They're going to keep testing the limits until they find a way to begin persecuting the church. Because persecution has to come. I believe that persecution must come to America because our faith needs to be tested. That's the time when we either put up or shut up. You know, it's as simple as that. I also believe that we're going to see a lot of plagues that are going to, you know, spontaneously erupt throughout the world. I wrote a lengthy article a few months ago, and at the time the swine flu was the big deal. Now, apparently it's back in the news. They're saying that the new strain doesn't really react to the medicine anymore. You know, there's so many things that are going on in the world right now that are all prophetic, that are all about what Jesus said in Matthew 24, that speak to Jeremiah, that speak to Ezekiel, that speak to Revelation, and the church is still sitting there going, you know, wake me up next week.
Wow. You know, and I'm glad you brought up the swine flu, because I really, really feel also, Brother Michael, that something is going to be happening in that category this fall. God's been warning his people to prepare, and that thing just has the hands of, you know, I don't want to get sidetracked, but it has the hands of manipulation all over it, that entire story, and I've gone into that in other audios, but I think that that's a story waiting to happen, and we're going to be faced with Psalms 91. So will the plague come into our dwelling, or will it not, is the big question. Will the people be hiding in the secret place, or will they not?
Well, and again, it's one of those things that no amount of money and no amount of stored food and no amount of guns can protect against. It's one of those things that only God can protect you against. You know, the World Health Organization, they just came out and said, the swine flu, unstoppable. You know, they're saying that in England, at least, or in London, 40 people a day could die by the end of this summer. You know, it's become resistant to Tamiflu, which is the thing that kind of took it down a notch. And we're seeing all these things, and it's not just one thing. You know, this is what amazes me, is that if it was just one thing, we could go, you know, it may be prophetic, it may not be prophetic, but there's at least a dozen things that are coming together in perfect unison, and the hand of God is directing it all. This is amazing to me. Everything is coming together, and the children of God need to wake up. This is the message of the hour. It's not about coming judgment. We can't give words of prophecy talking about coming judgment anymore, because it's here. Turn on the news. What we need to do is focus on righteousness and repentance. Focus on Christ, because he is the only protection that we have. He is the only means by which we will overcome the days that are coming.
Amen. Amen, Brother Michael. And, you know, you mentioned Romania and the Christians there. You said that you would get a breather when you go there. What is the difference between the church there and the church here? Is there one?
The church there already went through persecution. The church there knows what it means to be a Christian. They're not Christians because they own a business and they think they're going to get more business. They're Christians because they love Jesus. They're Christians because they suffered for the cause of Christ. They were in prison. They were tortured. They have family members that were killed. They don't buy into that whole God is my ATM nonsense. They're people of prayer. They're people of supplication. They're people of fasting, of reading the Word. And when I go there, I get humbled and I get recharged, and I see the power of God in a tangible way. You know, this is why I go back. They're simple people. You know, we have a church of about 1,000 right now. We started, it was just our family. There was like six people. Right now it's grown to about 1,000.